Welcome, everyone, on this beautiful, somewhat sunny day here. It's beautiful outside, but I see a lot of clouds out today. It's really nice to have you here with us this morning. I woke up to a lot of disturbing news this morning. Rattled me. There's further escalation of violence and another killing of a black man who was shot in the back. You know, whatever our opinion is, my opinion on it doesn't matter. What matters is God's opinion on it. And so it's up to us to seek out what he thinks. And the Bible makes it very clear, but this is a time for us to pray for peace, to pray for justice for all people, to pray for reconciliation. Jesus Christ tore down the dividing wall that separated the Gentiles and the Jews. And that same dividing wall has been torn down between all ethnicities in Jesus Christ. So let's begin with prayer this morning. Father, your word says that we are to maintain the unity of the Spirit within the body of Christ. Father, we need your Spirit this morning all across this nation, not just for those of us who have entrusted our life to Christ, but we need a fresh and mighty outpouring of your Spirit upon our nation, the Spirit of peace, the Spirit who brings peace. I pray that you would fill each one of us with an extraordinary measure of your Spirit this morning. We have not because we ask not. So today again, I ask big. I pray that you would give us a great measure of your Spirit in every way, in the gifts of the Spirit, in the fruit of the Spirit, in the leading of the Spirit, in our being empowered to walk in the Spirit, that we might worship in spirit and truth this morning. We entrust our nation into your hands, and we pray for better days for everyone than what we're going through now. We pray for better days for African Americans and for people of color. In the end, my simple prayer is, come, Lord Jesus, come. You have a perfect timing to it, and so you won't come until that perfect timing. But bring justice, Lord. Bring reconciliation. Bring a change of mind, that repentance of a change of mind and change of heart. Bring conviction to all people. Sin has ravaged our nation, Lord. Pour out your Spirit on us, Lord. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Again, it's really nice to have you here this morning with us. We are going to begin with a couple songs of worship. Mighty to Save, and then Nothing But the Blood. Hope you can sing along.
Never failing, and let mercy fall on me. Everyone needs forgiveness, the kindness of a Savior, the hope of nations. mighty to save, He is mighty to save. Forever author of salvation, He rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. Yes, You did, Lord. You're mighty to save. So take me as You find me, all my fears of failures. Fill my life again. Give my life to follow everything I believe in. Now I surrender all to You, Lord. Savior, He can move the mountains. My God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save.
Scripture reading this morning, we have a video rendering of Psalm 139.
When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw me. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. You have searched me, Lord, and you know me. You know when I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts from afar. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me, too lofty for me to attain. Where can I go from your spirit? Where can I flee from your presence? If I go up to the heavens, you are there. If I make my bed in the depths, you are there. If I rise on the wings of dawn, if I settle on the far side of the sea, even there your hand will guide me. Your right hand will hold me fast. If I say, surely the darkness will hide me, and the light become night around me. Even then, the night will shine like day, for darkness is as light to you. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. Search me, God, and know my heart. And lead me in the way everlasting. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made.
Let's pray. Father, again, I just thank you for today and for everyone gathered and for those who will be watching later on YouTube. I thank you for your presence with us, Lord. I thank you for that promise that to your body, that for those who have entrusted our lives to you, that you will by no means ever leave us nor forsake us. You have not left us orphaned on this earth. You've given us the companionship of the Holy Spirit. You have filled us with the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we pray for peace in our world today. We pray for peace in our nation. That into this tumult of injustice and violence, that you would speak, peace be still. That you would bring reconciliation. That you would bring renewed and a brand new justice. That you would bring police departments to get rid of officers who have been disciplined and officers who are questionable. I pray for peace, Lord. Words fail me. My own thoughts fail me, Lord. I sense that our nation is being brought into confusion and disorder on a whole number of levels, Lord. And so, Father, as a church, I pray for great discernment. Discernment from the Holy Spirit and discernment grounded in your word. That we would be a beacon of light, a beacon of hope, and a beacon of truth in the midst of great deception. I know from your word, Lord, that the enemy loves division. He loves to divide nations. He loves to divide peoples. He loves to divide churches, Lord. And so we ask for the unity of the Spirit in our own body. We ask for unity of the Spirit in the body of Christ across our nation. We ask for unity of the Spirit in the church across the globe, Lord. Father, it's not a unity that we can produce or make of our own effort or our own ability. It's unity who has its source, a unity which is a fruit of the Holy Spirit. We can't see the future, Lord. We don't know what's out there ahead of us. What will next year be like? What will next month be like? We are blind in of ourselves. And so lead us, Lord, along these unfamiliar paths. Guide us along paths that we have not tread before. And turn the rough places before us into level ground. Turn the darkness before us into light. And your word says that these things you will not leave undone, that you will accomplish them. So, Father, take us by the hand and lead us, guide us. Guide us into all truth in our own lives. Bring conviction into our lives where we need conviction by the Holy Spirit. If there is prejudice or racism in our own lives, I pray that by the Spirit of God that you would put it to death in us. Thank you, Lord. I pray that you would return this nation to the worship of our God, that you would bring this nation home, that you would bring this nation to its knees, seeking you, praying for your guidance, seeking your salvation. And I pray the same for the world, Lord. We pray for a revival, Lord. We pray for a great outpouring of your Spirit. Send a hurricane of your Spirit, Lord, in our lives. A tsunami of the river of the Holy Spirit all around the world, Lord. And I pray for this pandemic that you would bring it to pass. And yet, as I've been praying, take this cup from us, Lord. But not as we will. Your will be done. Amen. So we have a number of announcements this morning. I won't be broadcasting the noontime prayer and the reading of the Psalms this week. I have a doctor's appointment with my oncologist on Wednesday, and then Thursday I'm leading our pastor's group, our covenant pastor's group, so I won't be able to do it this week. But we will resume on Wednesday, June 24th, and on Thursday, June 25th, and we'll be covering Psalm 33 and 34. Our covenant group Bible study is up and running, gradually getting used to working with Zoom. I'd much rather be in person, but it's wise not to be in person right now. We'll be meeting this Thursday, June 18th, beginning at 7 p.m. If you're interested, you can call the church at 360-373-4332, or you can message me on Facebook. My wife Nancy is leading a women's Bible study on Saturdays, beginning each week at 3:30 p.m. via Zoom. The room opens up at 3 p.m. If you're interested, please call her at 360-479-6025, or she can be messaged on Facebook as well. Not next Sunday, which is Father's Day, but the following Sunday, we're going to be having a virtual potluck via Zoom after our service on Sunday, June 28th. Beginning at 1 p.m., and we're just going to be sharing a meal. You bring your own food, and we'll be setting up our computer so we can see everybody at the dinner table. And we would like you to join us with your dinner table and just a time to talk and to visit and to share a meal together. That will be on June 28th, beginning at 1 p.m. And again, if you could, those who are regular attenders of our church, if you could send in your contributions to 1211 Vanita Avenue, Bremerton, Washington, 98337. We appreciate it very much. We're holding our own, in fact, getting caught up just a little bit. So thank you for your generosity. And we're still on track to potentially open, tentatively open on August 2nd, on Sunday, August 2nd. It looks like we're in step with the phased opening with Governor Inslee's four-phased opening. And so we're going to be waiting to near the end of phase four to make sure we keep people safe. And I just appreciate your patience with us. I very much enjoy being with you on the internet, on Facebook. Well, that's our announcements for today. And before I begin my message, let's take a moment and pray. Father, again, you know I need you this morning. I woke up and maybe I shouldn't have read some news, but I felt led to, and it deeply disturbed me, Lord. So help me to get through my disturbance. I pray that your Holy Spirit would order my thoughts, that you would give me words, your words, Lord. I pray that the living word, or that your written word would be turned into a living word in each person's life. I thank you for each person hearing my words this morning, Lord. I pray that you would keep me from saying the things I don't need to and bring me to say the things I do. I set aside all pride and ego and attempts to impress, Lord, and I just pray that you'd give me again the grace to preach a message of grace and truth, a message of the promise of life, the promise of eternal life. And I pray for everyone listening that you would open our eyes, that you would open our ears, that you would open our lives to understand and to receive the word that you have for us. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. So we've been looking at the account of the Samaritan woman at the well and her encounter with Jesus, or rather Jesus' encounter with her. And we pick up the account in verse 27 of John. I'm going to read through it first, and then we'll work through it verse by verse. John chapter 4, verses 27 through 30. I'm kind of following the natural paragraphs of this account, so this is one of the paragraphs. John 4, 27 through 30. And again, I'll be reading from the New American Standard Bible. At this point, his disciples came, and they were amazed that he had been speaking with a woman. Yet no one said, "What do you seek?" or "Why do you speak with her?" So the woman left her water pot and went to the city and said to the men, "Come, see a man who told me all the things that I have done. This is not the Christ, is it?" They went out of the city and were coming to him. And so we begin with verse 27. At this point, his disciples came. And we see that at this point, at this time, at this very moment is the significant or the implication of those words. And so we see that moment when Jesus came is told to us in the verses immediately preceding, verses 25 and 26. Last week we saw the woman said to him, "I know that Messiah is coming, he who is called the Christ," which is Greek for Messiah, the anointed one. "When that one comes, he will declare all things to us." Jesus said to her, "I who speak to you am he." And last week we saw that literally, she's saying that one day the Messiah will come. And then Jesus said to her, "I am the one speaking to you." And so that "I am" is referencing the most holy name of God from Exodus chapter 3, verses 12 through around 16. It's the name Yahweh. I am who I am. I am the Lord, Yahweh. At this point, and so it's right at the point Jesus reveals to the woman that he's the Messiah, that the disciples come back. It seems kind of an unfortunate intrusion into their conversation. At this point, his disciples came. Isn't that how it always goes? You're in the midst of a significant conversation, an intimate moment, speaking with your wife or with your husband, or and then there's an interruption. At this point, his disciples came. And it says, and they were amazed. I love this word. It occurs throughout the Gospels. One of my family members told me years ago that I use this word too much in my sermons, too much amazement. But I am amazed at our Lord Jesus Christ, his glory, his kindness, his boundless, unconditional love with which he has loved you and with which he has loved me. It says they were amazed. And so the word, I won't read the Greek there, but the best rendering of it I could find was they were shocked, flabbergasted. And so from, again, that premier dictionary of the Greek New Testament, Bauer, Arndt, Gingrich, and Danker, we read to be extraordinarily impressed or disturbed by something. So it can be either in a positive direction or a negative direction. And in this context, it seems to be in a negative direction. They were shocked that Jesus was speaking with a woman. It means to wonder, marvel, to be astonished at. And again, the context determines whether it is in a good or bad sense, to wonder at, to be surprised at. I like the word shocked. They were shocked that he was speaking with a woman. And again, what were they amazed at? What were they shocked at? That he had been speaking with a woman. It's hard for us to understand what that meant in that culture. We live in a culture where men and women are friends, where we go out to lunch at times. I have somewhat refrained from doing some of that in my life because my role as pastor, but I know that a lot of you have friends. But let's take a look at their perspective from their culture. This is from, again, the Gospel According to John by Leon Morris, one of my favorite commentaries on the Gospel of John. And so this is from a rabbinic source. A man shall not be alone with a woman in an inn, not even with his sister or his daughter, on account of what men may think. A man shall not walk with a woman in the street, not even with his own wife, and especially not with another woman, on account of what men may say. So this is one of those fence rules that the rabbis had come up with to surround the law of do not commit adultery or do not fornicate, those kinds of laws from the Old Testament, from the law, from the Pentateuch. Get this, a man shall not even speak with his own wife on the street. And here Jesus is speaking with this strange woman by themselves at a lonely place. It's full of scandal, the potential for scandal, and for the appearance of wrongdoing, for the appearance of it. And that's what these rabbis were getting at. Or again, we find, again from the Gospel of John, if any man gives his daughter a knowledge of the law, it is though he taught her lechery, which is akin to prostitution. So in that day, the rabbis, the Jewish people, the Israelites, the Hebrew people, did not believe in educating their daughters because they thought it would be dangerous to their morality. And we think, what foolishness. How could they be thinking that? And I agree. It's a different society than what we're used to. Or again, this is a quote from Leon Morris from his commentary. A very ancient prayer still found in the Jewish book runs, "Blessed art thou, O Lord, who hast not made me a woman." And they would pray a prayer of thanksgiving that God didn't make them a woman. And it's into that culture, into that sexist culture, that Jesus appears. And it's more than remarkable to me that the first person Jesus reveals himself to, that he is the Messiah, that he is the Christ, is a woman. So I find three reasons to be shocked why the disciples were amazed and shocked that he was speaking with a woman. First of all, she was a woman, and so everything I just read was part of their culture and part of how they saw women and how they responded to women. They were second-class citizens. They were always under the authority of a father, a husband, or a brother. There were a few landed women who owned their own property and owned their own land, but they were rare. So it's amazing that Jesus is speaking with a woman just because of the sexism and of their day. Secondly, she was a Samaritan woman. And as we have seen, Judeans did not have anything to do with Samaritans. The Samaritans had offered to help build the temple when the Judeans were brought back out of exile from Babylon. And the Judeans, the Jews, refused to accept the Samaritans' help, which created animosity. So the Samaritans turned around and built a temple on Mount Gerizim, which summarily the Judeans came and destroyed. So that only heightened the escalation of violence. And they had, the Samaritans, as we have seen, were descendants of the people who had been left in 722 when the Assyrians had come in and carted the nation of Israel off to captivity, but they had left some of the Israelites in the land. And then other people groups, Canaanites and other people groups from the Assyrian Empire, were brought in. They intermarried with the Israelites, with the Hebrew people. And so the Samaritans were seen as, I hate the word, but they were seen as half-breeds, as traitors to the purity of the Hebrew ethnicity. And so there was, we talk about racism. There's a lot of racism from the Jews, the Judeans, to the Samaritans. And a lot of hatred went both ways. And then the third reason, she was a woman of disreputable reputation. And so she had a highly questionable character, having been married 5 times, and now in a society that upheld the law, the Samaritans only accepted the 5 books of the law, which of course condemns fornication, sleeping with a woman or with a man before marriage, that condemns adultery. She'd been married 5 times. She was a 5-time loser because men could only divorce women. It didn't work the other way. They could request a divorce. And men could only divorce, a person could only be divorced 3 times in that culture. And she had been divorced 5 times. And now she's just living with a man. Forget the law. Forget. You know, I think we all have this dream of having a wonderful marriage and having a family and children. I know Nancy's my best friend. We have grown into our love for each other. I loved her when I married her, but nothing at all like how I love her now. I have a good life and a good wife. But this woman's dreams of having that kind of life have been destroyed 5 times. And we're not told the reason why behind it. Any speculation would be just that, speculation. But she has been so disappointed in her life that she's given up on the institution of marriage and now just living with a man. And she's been coming likely at the heat of the day, at noontime, to avoid the other women, their derision, their names, their name-calling. This woman was bottom of the barrel. And I imagine that you could tell by her appearance. There is a certain hardness that gets etched into our lives, no matter what we do. So I have a very ruddy face. Some people say, well, that you're ruddy-faced anyway, but alcoholism etches itself into people's physique. And even though I quit 36 years ago, that alcoholism has still etched itself into my face. So these disciples had multiple reasons for being shocked that Jesus would be talking to this woman. She was a woman. She was a Samaritan, which also meant she shared a different religion, a kind of modified, what the Judeans and the Hebrew people considered a heretical religion, because they had rejected the rest of the Old Testament, the rest of the Hebrew scriptures. So it wasn't only the fact that she was of different ethnicity, but that she was also of a different faith, in a sense, in a very real sense, and that she was a woman of disreputable reputation. They were shocked. And I like their response, yet no one said. And why weren't they saying? Well, we don't really know. But some leading possibilities, one is that they were embarrassed to ask him, because from all outward appearances, given what I had read this morning, and from that culture's view on this, it's kind of an embarrassing thing that Jesus was talking to this woman. What was he up to? This isn't the Jesus we know. Let's not ask him. Or maybe, as another commentary pointed out, maybe it's that they know if they do say something to him, they'll get reprimanded, they'll get set straight. So they're keeping silent for their own preservation. Yet no one said they're a bunch of cowards. I suspect it's out of embarrassment, not knowing what to say. It's awkward. It's scandalous that he's talking with her, that he's alone with her. The appearance of it is scandalous. Yet no one said, "What do you seek?" Well, we know the answer to that question, "What do you seek?" This is found this in a Baker commentary. It's quite obvious to me now that I see it. What do you seek? In John 4:7, we read, "There came a woman of Samaria to draw water. Jesus said to her, 'Give me a drink.'" So what is Jesus seeking? He's seeking a drink of water from the woman. That's all, just a drink of water. And then the question, "Why do you speak with her?" That's answered too. And we find in John chapter 4, verses 13 and 14, these words, "Jesus answered her and said to her, 'Everyone who drinks of this water,'" the water from Jacob's well, "will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him shall never thirst. But the water that I will give him will become in him a well of water springing up to eternal life." And so Jesus is offering this water, and we know it's the water of the Holy Spirit, that once you take a drink of it, it will spring up in your life to eternal life. One drink, not a series of drinks, not a lifetime of drinking. One drink, and we know that you're given the gift of eternal life. I know last week, one of you, I hope you're there. I won't name you, but I'm so excited. I meant to write you, but I got so busy this week, I didn't have time. I like to actually write with meaning and not just drop a note. But I was so excited, along with our whole church, that you have become a brother in Christ. We are praying for you. We are praying for your family, that they would come to know the tender, sweet presence and grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, that they too might come to believe, and by believing that they might receive the gift of eternal life. And one of the highlights of my entire ministry, just want to let you know, I've never met any of you, but I love you dearly. We're praying for your safety, praying for peace in that nation as well, in the nation you're serving in. Jesus answered and said to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again, but whoever drinks of the water that I will give him shall never thirst." Never thirst for unconditional love, never thirst for presence, never thirst for companionship, never thirst for eternal hope, never thirst for the presence of the one who made us to be loved by him, who put in us this longing for unconditional, boundless, immeasurable love, who put in us this longing for eternity. And I'll give him, but the water that I will give him will become in him, in her, a well of water springing up to eternal life. And so when Jesus, what the disciples might have asked, "Why do you speak with her?" Get this, Jesus was speaking with the woman at the well, the Samaritan woman at the well, so he could give to her eternal life. That's why he was speaking to her. Nothing shady, nothing scandalous, nothing questionable. Because he had that alone time with her, he was able to call her into account, not in a harsh way, but in a very gentle way, revealing her sin, so that he might give her grace, so that he might give her the gift of eternal life. So he's seeking a drink of water, but he's speaking with her so that he can, in return, give her the gift of eternal life. And I can't help but remember John 4:4, where John says, and he had to pass through Samaria. There's this must-ness to it. There's this should-ness to it. He had to go through Samaria. And when you understand that he had to go through Samaria to meet this woman so that he could give her eternal life. I don't think she's a woman who walked away from the gift. I wholeheartedly believe that, or know that she received the gift. What an exciting thing to move from the kingdom of darkness to the kingdom of our beloved Son. to move from eternal death into eternal life, to not come into judgment, to be saved from the great white throne judgment, where we will be held accountable for our sins. Jesus says later in chapter 5, coming up, "Truly, truly, I say to you, he who hears my word and believes him who sent me has eternal life." Does not come into judgment. Does not come into judgment. But has passed. And the sense of it there is already passed from death into life. What kind of death? Eternal death. And what kind of life? Into eternal life. The moment you came to believe, the moment you accepted Christ, the moment you said, "Save me, Jesus, forgive me, Jesus," he gave you the gift of eternal life. "I'm living eternally. I know one day this body is going to stop breathing, this heart will stop breathing, but I will yet live. To be absent from the body is to be home with the Lord," according to Paul. We are surrounded by so great a cloud of witnesses who lived through the same kinds of trials, the same kind of tumult in their lives. And yet, because of the grace of Christ, finished the race, finished the course. And now we are surrounded by those witnesses. Moving on to verse 28. "So the woman left her water pot and went into the city and said to the men." So she left her water pot. And there's all kinds of conjecture on why she left her water pot. And we'll take a look at those possible reasons for why this woman left her water pot. Probably the most prominent in the reading I did, about 10 different commentaries I read. I like reading. I do other study first, so I kind of make up my own mind. Then I see what is said in the commentaries. All along, praying that the Holy Spirit would open my eyes to understand the word. So the first reason is, in her excitement, she just forgets it. She leaves it. But it doesn't say, "So the woman forgot her water pot and went to the city." It says that she left it and went into the city. Secondly, the idea is that she left it so that Jesus and his disciples could quench their thirst. Hearing what Jesus had said, there is a day coming when the place where we worship won't matter, but the Father desires those who will worship in spirit and in truth. Therefore, the dividing wall between Samaritans and Judeans and Samaritans and the Hebrew people will be torn down in the cross of Jesus Christ. And so it doesn't matter if they drink from her water pot. And maybe it's an act of care of this woman to help quench Jesus' thirst and the disciples' thirst. She knows that Jesus is thirsty. He's already asked her for a drink, and as far as we know, she never gave it to him. So maybe this is an act of kindness to the one who she is coming to believe in. Number three, she left it because she was going to go into town, get the townsfolk, the townspeople, and then come back. She was fully intending to return. And I think that's a viable inference from the passage. And then there's a more far-fetched one, and I think this is far-fetched. She was symbolically leaving her old religion behind to embrace the gift of eternal life, to embrace this new kind of faith. Well, John may have loosely been implying that, but I think that's a bit of a reach, because the water pot she had no religious significance to it. So I think probably 2 and 3 are my favorites. But again, does it tell us? No. All we know is she left her water pot. And what did she do? She went into the city and said to the men. So that men, that word men there isn't male. It isn't speaking of males per se. It's a word that means, it can mean men, but it's a word that means people. And there's debate on whether they mean men, literally male, the male people of the city of Sychar, or if she went to talk to the people of Sychar. And I imagine it's both, because in that language of the New Testament, there is also a word for men, and John could have used that term. There's the thought that if it was men, she knew where the men of the city lived. She had been married to five of them. And maybe other men in the city knew her, if you get my drift. But we're not told. And so I take it to mean people. She went into the city and said to the people. And then we get to John chapter 4, verses 29 and 30. She says to these people, "Come, see a man who told me all the things that I have done. This is not the Christ, is it?" They went out of the city and were coming to him. And so she asks us, or she makes this proclamation, "Come, see a man who told me all the things that I have done." Well, we know that in the time spent, their conversation was probably longer than what we have recorded. But suffice it to say, Jesus had told her pretty much the scope of her life in shorthand, in summarized fashion. It's found in John chapter 4, verses 16 and 17. Jesus said to her, "Go call your husband and come here," knowing that she did not have a husband right now. The woman answered and said, "I have no husband." Jesus said to her, "You have correctly said, I have no husband." And if you go on, it says, I forgot to put the rest of it. That's verse 17. So in verse 18, it says, "For you have had five husbands, and the one you have now is not your husband. This you have said truly." So she's had five husbands and now living with a man. And this is how she gets, "Come see a man who told me all the things that I've done." Those five husbands and the man she's living with now span a whole lifetime of living. "Come, see a man who told me all the things that I have done." Must have been a complete shock for her. It's why she's avoiding coming to the well, likely, at other times in the day because of this life. And now this man, this Judean, has the audacity to call her out on the carpet. But Jesus never calls us out on the carpet to harm us. He always convicts us and reveals to us who we are to show us further and deeper grace. And then she asks this question, "This is not the Christ, is it?" This is a very Japanese way of speaking. She puts it in the negative. This isn't the Christ, is it? This is not the Christ, is it? So she's... Some people think that she was doubting. I don't think she's doubting. I think she knows that given her low standing in the society, if she comes and says, "Hey, I found the Messiah. I discovered the Messiah," they'd go, "Oh, right, forget you. We don't believe you." But by putting it in the negative and having that little bit of that tinge of uncertainty, "This is not the Christ, is it?" It leaves it then open to the townspeople of Sychar, the city of Sychar, to decide for themselves. "This is not the Christ, is it?" Which then creates a hunger, a wonder. Could the Messiah have come to Samaria? Because the Samaritans were also looking for a Messiah that would be patterned after the prophet Moses. I love this. This woman becomes, in what I believe to be her newfound faith, she immediately becomes the first evangelist recorded in the Gospels. Not the disciples, not a person from Judea, not a Galilean, not a Hebrew person, not an Israelite, but a woman. And not only a woman, but a Samaritan woman. Of a heretical faith and of a bloodline that has been made impure, and a woman of complete reputable reputation or irreputable rep, or let's see, a woman of ill repute, of questionable character. In our world, if you're going to find a witness, you're going to find the best the world has to offer. If you are in a court case, you want people not of questionable character, you want people of stellar character. But Jesus doesn't operate the way we do. He doesn't follow our dictates. He doesn't follow our guidelines. He doesn't follow our presuppositions. He chooses the most unlikely, bottom of the barrel person who was a throwaway from the Hebrew understanding, from the Judean understanding, a throwaway because she was just a woman in that culture, as we have seen. And a woman who was a throwaway person, a smoldering wick, a bruised reed in her own society, avoiding the women of her day. I love it. She leaves her water pot. She came to get water at a time when she wouldn't run into other people. Now she runs back to tell these very people. This is not the Messiah, is it? This is not the Christ, is it? The one who is coming to deliver us. And she's a smart woman. She knows how to put the question in such a way that they will come to see for themselves. And then we read that they went out of the city and were coming to him. And again, the grammar of this is interesting, is significant, because it's not they were just coming out of the city and were coming to him. The sense of it can mean that they were coming out of the city and began coming to him. But the overall focus of this is a continual stream of people then started coming out of the city, a stream of people, not just a few. You know how word goes? It doesn't happen so much in our town. Well, it does over the phone and texting and so on. But word would travel very fast through a city like that. They had friends running over to each other. And so now we find out later on that much of the city came out to be with Jesus. And he ends up staying with them for 3 days. The first ethnic group to come to Christ weren't Hebrew people, weren't Judeans, weren't Israelites. They were Samaritans. And a stream of people now start coming out to see Jesus, all because of this one woman, this woman of questionable character, saying, I met a man who told me everything I've ever done. This is not the Christ, is it? Jesus knew exactly what he was doing in finding this woman. It wasn't just for the Samaritan's sake, it was for the sake of this woman. The great love he had for her, and the great love which he has for you. I began with Psalm 139 this morning because, get this, he knit this woman while she was yet in her mother's womb. He knit you together while you were yet in your mother's womb. He knows every fiber of your being, every cell. He has the hairs on your head numbered. He knows when we lie down and when we stand up. Where can I go from your spirit? If I go into the depths of the sea, you are there. And out of great love for the woman, out of great love for the Samaritans, out of great love for you, he found this woman. Do you know that she's still evangelizing? She's evangelizing us today. Her story, her account. I love this story. I love this account. It's a real event. Shows you the tender-hearted God that we have. In the midst of the violence and the racial injustice, and we all have our own take and our own opinions on it, but into that realm of opinion and debate and comes Jesus, meeting with the most unlikely person. Who is the person at the bottom of your barrel of a different ethnicity? That's who Jesus meets with. He meets with all of us. He loves us all. Love covers over a multitude of sins. What we need in our world today is the love of God, His presence. And again, I think of those words, and He had to pass through Samaria. He had to pass through Samaria so He could ask a drink of this woman, so that He could offer her the gift of eternal life by taking one drink. And it's quite apparent to me that she has taken that drink, going back, knowing how to deftly say, "This is not the Christ, is it? I met a man who told me everything I've ever done. This is not the Messiah, is it?" And as a result, the city of Samaria comes streaming out to Jesus. I think about my own life. After that head injury I had in 1983, I was drunk and hit my head against a curb, lost my ability to speak, let it bleed for 24 hours before going into the hospital. Dr. Lozier, the head of the neurology department, said, I don't think you're going to live, Grant, but if you do, you'll never speak again. Because I had, unbeknownst at the time, I got my chart later, years later, while I was here in Bremerton, I ordered my chart from University of Washington. I always thought he was trying to scare me because of my addictions. But when I got when I received my chart and had my neurologist at the time, Dr. Neocon, read it and explain it to me, I had 5 bleeds in my brain and one in my Broca's area, which is my speech center, and it was a large hematoma in my speech center. I have a hole in my brain. Explains a lot, doesn't it? Yeah. But the point of my story is I had nowhere to turn, and so my father and my new mother, who's sitting here with us today, invited me to come and live with them in Olympia. And my dad took me to my first AA meeting. And at that meeting, he actually came to 2 or 3 meetings, and he drove me after that for months to my AA meetings, and he would sit out in the car. But I met a man at that meeting by the name of Johan. I don't know his last name. He had hair down to here. I'm on my way. This is as long as my hair has been since 1978. But Johan had hair down to here. He had an equally long beard. He looked like Cousin It. And he would sit in that hall down in downtown Olympia with all those old timers. It was a large meeting of about 60 people. 60 to 65 people would be there. A lot of old-time recovering alcoholics. And he would speak openly of the unconditional love of Christ. And then he would invite us out after the meeting to go to Denny's, and we would sit around and drink coffee. And he would bring out this old King James Bible and open up passages of grace. And I read them for the first time, and I would say, that can't be. That can't be true. That's not what I grew up hearing. He said, "Grant, it's the Bible. Read it again." And I read again, and it was this healing balm of the grace of Jesus. I had always heard that you had to change yourself in order to come to Jesus. Then He would accept you. That was the message of legalism. Then I discovered through His written word that we come to Jesus just as we are, and He changes us. But what does this have to do with He had to pass through Samaria? Well, Johan gave me tapes on the covenant by a man named Malcolm Smith. Radically changed my life, changed my perception of Christianity forever. I discovered grace through Johan. The Lord showed me grace through Johan. Johan had to be in Bremerton because Jesus was in Johan, and he had to be in Bremerton. He was here illegally from the Netherlands. He was Dutch. And he was deported just a few months after that. I didn't realize that until years later when I met one of my friends from that AA meeting, and he told me, well, not too long after he was meeting with you at Denny's, Grant, the authorities caught him and shipped him back to the Netherlands. And I'm thinking, that man was in Olympia, not by chance. Jesus will find you. In the same way that by this pandemic, some of you are hearing my word now, and I'm just passing on what was given to me. We are eternal friends, you and I. I'm so glad that Jesus has found you. And I'm speaking of all of you. I'm so glad he found that woman. Because it speaks volumes into who he accepts and who he doesn't accept. It doesn't say anything about who he doesn't accept. All it says is, he wins over, he approaches even the people who would be considered the absolute bottom of the barrel in that society. And to that woman, he revealed himself, I am the Christ. And to that woman, he gave the message to go and be the first evangelist. This is not the Christ, is it? This is not the Messiah, is it? And Jesus' answer was, I am. I am the Messiah. I am the one speaking to you. Amen. I want to read through the text one more time. At this point, his disciples came, and they were amazed that he had been speaking with a woman, yet no one said, what do you seek, or why do you speak with her? So the woman left her water pot and went into the city and said to the men, come and see a man who told me all the things that I have done. This is not the Christ, is it? They went out of the city and were coming to him. And again from John chapter 4, verse 4, and Jesus had to pass through Samaria. He'll do whatever it takes to reach us, to reach you. Amen. Well, again, thanks for joining me today. We have a closing song. You are my all in all.
My strength when I am weak, you are the treasure that I seek, you are my all in all. Seeking you as a precious jewel, Lord, to give up I'd be a fool, you are my all in all. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name. Jesus, Lamb of God, worthy is your name.
Well, again, thank you for joining me today. I'm jazzed about the events from last week. I'm thrilled. I think about the nature of the pandemic. I know some of us, including me, have complained, why is this taking so long? Yet because of the pandemic, we were able to go to live streaming and to have our broadcast heard around the world, in Iraq, in Pakistan, in Spain, all around our nation, in Texas, in California, in Nevada, New York, Wisconsin, Maryland, Virginia, Idaho, Hawaii. I count it an honor. Thank you for watching. Thank you for listening. We have such good news. Life-transforming news. News that has already happened. Jesus giving up his life. Jesus being raised from the dead. Jesus ascending into heaven so that he could give us the gift of the Holy Spirit. Don't forget to ask. Ask every day, fill me with your Holy Spirit. Not woodingly or legalistically, but out of joy. Today, Lord, fill my life with your Spirit. Your will be done, not mine. Let's close in prayer. Father, as the years recede behind us, your word tells us to forget what lies behind and to press on in that upward call in our Lord Jesus Christ. We pray for better years for our nation, Lord. Better years in which there will be justice for all people. Justice for African Americans. The same rights. Not guilty until we're proven. We're not innocent until we're not proven guilty. Father, bring a new day to our nation. A day of peace, a day in which we return to our God. The stakes are high, Lord. Because we know that you, I can't say tolerate, but you allow nations to fill up their sin to a certain threshold. And once we reach that threshold, you remove that nation's light. You remove that nation's existence. Father, we call out to you. Save our world. Save all of our nations. Save Iraq and Canada and the United States and Mexico and Iran and India. So many nations around the world. France and Germany and Spain and England, Great Britain. Again, we pray for a great outpouring of your Spirit, Lord. We cry out to you, Lord. Come, Lord Jesus, come. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our blessing today is found in Psalm 146, verses 5 through 7. Blessed are those whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord their God. He is the maker of heaven and earth, the sea, and everything in them. He remains faithful forever. He upholds the cause of the oppressed and gives food to the hungry. The Lord, Yahweh, sets prisoners free.